a little bit of demo.
Okay, well, I'll just quickly introduce you. So, everybody, this is Chris Murawski. Is that correct? Oh, all right. I can't even attempt your name. Chris is here today to talk about F1000, and his colleague has kindly created this lovely poster here, which we'll talk all about. I can say firstly that there's a lot of sort of buzz around F1000 and the good work that they're doing to sort of provide a way for people to disseminate information and to obviously curate their work. So I'll let Chris do the talking. So thanks again, Chris, for coming on the floor.
Thank you very much for your interest and for coming to speak about such lovely things like searching online. We had this company for a couple of years, and Olya's name is there. I can send you the presentation afterwards, so you can use it. The company was founded by this gentleman here, and he also founded Biomed Central some time ago. Some of you might have been using it occasionally. And he also founded F1000 Research. Until mid-January, it was one company. F1000 Research was open access, workspace, and Prime, with two databases. But then suddenly it turned out that it was sold to Helen Francis. So the company's been separated, and I'm left with the two other items. But if you have questions about open access, we can also talk about this, because part of what we're trying to do, actually all of it is centered about open science and how to make science more open or use the new technologies and tools to facilitate communication and make it more direct and independent of all the other stakeholders that are intervening in the process. The more it gets complicated and bigger, science as such, there's more and more stakeholders, I think, in it. So there's a couple of things that we're, I think, in the center of our thinking. Is that impact factor evaluation, which is base of your evaluation process, of your grant receiving process, institutions evaluation process is based on impact factors, basically, one way or another. And it's, of course, not the best of possible solutions. Automating searching for literature could be better, and working together online could be better, but it always can be better. And we've been trying to work to transform the science, the way the science is communicated, by providing innovative solutions. So we're in a way a ever-existing startup. We start with a small company, we found it internally, develop and then sell, and then have resources to find another development. So that was how Biomed Central emerged, how 1000 Research emerged, and how those other things that we built emerged as well. So the ideal is to have our academic communication is open, direct, immediate, and transparent. We've been talking about experience with psychology theories. I think all the 20th century was full of theories of psychology which dominated a lot of public life, social life, from psychoanalysis on. That never were open, never were direct, never were immediate and transparent. I remember a lecture by Ernst Gellner was a philosopher at the opening of a CEU campus in Warsaw. He said, well, psychoanalysis was one of the worst things that could happen in the 20th century, basically. And it was not founded on science, basically. So we're trying to work towards making it open, direct, immediate, and transparent, and build those two tools currently. F1000 Prime, which is a tool that should help researchers to find relevant research. Normally, how you look for research? You ask your colleagues, you go to conferences, you have all those online databases, they are more or less automated, because the things go in and there are search tools and you search. And all the findings are on the basis on some automatic criteria. Impact factor is one of them. Number of citations is another one. And all similar, basically. So we're trying to build it in a different way. And Workspace, it's just a reference manager. One of the newest on the market, maybe. So maybe it's not the best, but it's the newest and most flexible using modern technology. Olya is one of the developers, so she can tell you more during or afterwards. F1000 Prime. It's an expert-based recommendation service. We have about 8,000 faculty members all over the world. We call them our faculty members from various fields. And they write recommendations for articles they find interesting. So it's not automatic recommendation. It doesn't cover all the field. I mean, it doesn't cover all the articles. We have something close to 200,000, more or less, of those recommendations. We cover a fraction of what is published in PubMed. And if you imagine on PubMed, you have 3,000 articles per day. And in Embase, you have 4,500 articles published per day. So it's, I don't know, 5,000 maybe. And it's not all. So it's difficult to find your way through all that stuff. You face it probably every day, almost. So what we did was this: bring specialists in biology and medicine, psychology, and psychiatry, and as of last year also psychology. It's not listed here, but it's been developed. Divided by faculties in all those fields. And they write those short interviews. I just talked with a researcher from GlaxoSmithKline, and he's one of our faculty members, so he's writing those reviews. He's not really using it very much himself, but he said that, well, first of all, he spent so much time on finding the right literature that he wants to share it. And the why for him is also that the important literature is not always the one coming from the top impact factor journals, or not the newest one. He gave an example of malaria research. Well, most of malaria research was done in the 40s and 50s of the last century. It's not even on PubMed, because PubMed doesn't reach that far. And most of important research was done at that time. So how to get to this research? You can't rely really on automatic tools. You have to use your connections to your friends and beg them for old articles. Coronavirus research, again. Most of the research is 12 years old. So if you look for the most current, you find a lot, but you don't find the most relevant literature. So on his, it was his idea, and we're trying now to build a collection of recommendations on coronavirus research. Available. So we send message to researchers to bring what they think is important for coronavirus research, and then we create a collection. That's an example. Those are the faculty members here. Kings. And they are in psychology. I think there's a couple more, but those are examples of people who write those reviews for us. So going online. Yeah, well, that's all. They are organized in... I think I'm... Yeah. Okay. So they are organized in sections as head of faculty, none of those is. There are section heads, so Deakin, Professor Deakin, he's the head of one of those sections. And faculty members and associate faculty members. Being an associate faculty member means you depend on, like this guy here, I think. Swally, do you know him? I don't. How you do? So he's a faculty member of Alan Young. Might not even be from your institute, but he's sort of his supervisor. And the positive thing for young people here is that they can write those reviews, and they are DOI, so they are publications by themselves. And they don't need to be long. They rather should be short. Okay. Just to keep with the story. Yeah, so I checked Lee, and that's how I knew that she's doing research on child and adolescent psychiatry, and I looked her supervisor up, and then to find some ideas what sort of search might be relevant for you to see here, although you're welcome to try your own now or later. I did a search based on this article here. This here. I'm not sure it's relevant. Sorry, it's out of my field, so I'm doing a guesswork, but that's how I've been trying to do it. So I found an article that somehow within the field of research of the lady on the other slide, and then based on this article, I created a smart search for other things. And that's the smart search, where you can have those articles recommended to you, and you can say whether it's relevant or non-relevant, and your search alert is modified according to what you put inside, and then brings you things that are supposedly interesting, important from your field. That's how it works. You can say, well, this, you won't see this part, because that's for faculty members, but anybody else can say the article, check if it's relevant or non-relevant, and then the search is modified.
Sorry, I need to click on this go into the real world. You see, this is this article, and I created a smart search. But basically, that's how those recommendations look like. There's an original article with a DOI here, and author's affiliations here. None is from King's, but and then there's a recommendation written by this professor from Houston, and that's
how it looks. It's classified as a review, and it's good for teaching. This one. And I think there's three recommendations for the same article. So this is one of an article reference, also written by those two people. There are references also linked here.
Does anybody sort of edit, is there an editor that sort of adjudicates whether the reviews are okay or not?
No.
So
it's between those guys here. There's the faculty heads, there are section heads, and they are faculty members, and they are supposed to be mature enough to really make sure it's relevant. And then it's public knowledge, so it's transferred.
So there's no, I guess, you know, you could get one kind review.
Yeah, you can, but then you can comment
right,
on it, and anybody can comment on it. So you're looking at this one.
And can you rate the quality of the review?
Yeah, you can put a comment there, I think. Yeah. Well, you can recommend this article, you can dissent, and you can create a comment. So you can add a comment here, and it will be saved forever with your name. And of course, you can write to those people as well to tell them what you think. Yeah. It's not supposed to be a place to put negative reviews. It's rather a place to put positive reviews. So there's a possibility, and I maybe go to the main interface. And you see, it can be rated as very good, exceptional good, or decent. That's a way to phrase your distance, say, from the finding. But it's not a tool to find to present negative comments. The idea is to find interesting and important. And then they can be classified according to those criteria, and then the types of article, clinical trial, randomized review, or systematic review. So if you find an interesting article, you can create a smart search around, and it is expected to learn from your reactions to the to those suggestions you get. So this smart search here, okay. That's the one here. So I can include, I'm doing it in randomly at the moment, but the search will learn from what I'm doing currently. There's actually quite many, 24 of those recommenders. Well, I created maybe 2 weeks ago, so it brought a lot of literature. And you see there's a lot of other searches I created. You can also do PubMed search or bring articles from PubMed to seed your alert base, sort of. So it doesn't mean it's a universal tool to find everything that is important in your field. It's not good for that. It's good to pick up the important pieces of information, but not always everything. And I've been checking with a number of people, and if you try using it, I would be very much interested in your comments. How well targeted is it for your use? Whether you really found there's something interesting or not really. So if you could communicate back after potentially trying it, I would be very much interested in your comments. So what you can do from here, you can look for articles, but you can also follow the faculty members and their recommendations or a section. So there's neurological diseases, psychology, psychiatry. Let's settle for psychiatry. And there's a couple of sections that you can search. Alzheimer, I've been talking, somebody's been talking about Chaitin, adolescent psychiatry, mood disorders, etc. And you have faculty members who are dealing with those areas, 32 from those two or three sections. So you can basically look at their work or the institutions they come from, and in a way you also find an evaluation of institution based on the output. If you were looking, for example, to find out something about an institution called King's College by authors' affiliation. It's probably will pick up all. So there's 880 results from authors are coming from King's College. So in a way, that's also a tool to evaluate an institution you're trying to partner. Quite many institutions will be there. There are Nobel Prizes among the faculty members, currently 6 or 7. So
they come and they go. We have 8,000 of them, but there's about 20,000 lapsed already. So we have an editorial team who is working with the faculty members to make sure that they really follow certain quality requirements we impose, and also chase them to produce. Most of them are quite busy, so it's a full-time job. So in this way, you can sort it by recommendation date, number of recommendations, or most viewed, whatever it is. You see, there's been this one has been recommended by 5 people from various places, and new finding, interesting hypothesis, new finding, exceptional, and it's a DOI publication. So if you're interested and you find faculty members, even from your institution, from somewhere else, you might we'll try to work with them, potentially, and try to use the tool. Okay. So this is one thing. And now the other one. Workspace. It's a reference manager. There's thousands, or maybe not thousands, but there's a lot, various of different reference managers. This one. And it's expected to help you writing, but also collaborating. So it has collaboration tools built into it. There's been a number of people who like it. There are articles, you can find it. And the important thing is that it works on various machines, PC, Mac, tablet, mobile phones, integrated with Word. That's why I wanted to use my laptop to show the Google Docs. And
I talked with the people in NHS in Scotland. They use it, and they even get very emotional, explaining how it's so great for them, because they have different barriers between different, it's one institution, but they have firewalls all over the place. So they are able to communicate all over and then produce results together without those barriers, so relatively smoothly. Okay, so again, going back here, there's a couple of recommendations I've been searching in Prime, but I can search also in PubMed. Anything clever? Autism? So there's been some results. It's 20 on this page. And I have this tiny button here where I can pick either some of them or all of them. And bring it into my Workspace account. Creating a new project, maybe just especially for this purpose, and importing them there. Okay. You see, it's a new one here with this tiny button, means there's some new things added. And I have those 5 references here with links. None of them were open access. If those articles were open access, the PDF would be imported directly, automatically. But then, if you click on this one, you should get to the institution account, except that you wouldn't now, because I'm not on the university network. And there are also some suggestions, right away, very quickly, of other things that we think that might be relevant based on the content of those references important. So I can add one or two to a project to have seven. And the important thing is that you can add here PDF normally. You can upload PDF and you can add supplementary data. So if you do research and have supplementary data, you can add it there. Any kind of files. And then if you have this project, you can share it with other people. You just put the emails there and they receive an email potentially with a message from you, and the content is shared. That means you can share the notes you create and the references and the PDFs and all what's in the project. And now if we were to write something, I have this icon here added to Word. Normally you, if you're in Workspace, you can install Firefox extension, Firefox because it's Firefox. It would normally recognize the and work plugin. It's installed, it's recognized and so new version? Olya?
It depends on the version.
Yeah, so it, potentially there's a new version I could install, but let's just skip it. And some text. And then if you would like to add references to this text, potentially from this project I just created. You see they are listed here and I add them at the end of the text. Oops. This one also is recognized as recommended in Prime. Adding them here. Actually, I have been using Vancouver style, but let's go to something more psychological. So that's the text, and those are the notes. And if I now want to create bibliography, I got bibliography. If I don't like the style, I can change it from here. So I change the style. So this is easy to do. And now, let's say okay. I can't do this now from to save it to the project I created because it's not a shared project. This autism. So I will add it to one of those other projects that are there that are shared with other people. I'll be sharing it with people who are using this project called Open Access. It's the safest one because I'm sharing it with just myself, a different account. All right, so the text is here, but it also appears here as a part of Workspace. But the text is here, so I can even place comments here. So if I go to this project, you see there are references.
There are some suggestions, probably not so many in this case. There are notes and manuscripts. And And that's where we are. So we have this manuscript. There was one added in December, and this one added right now. So it's part of a shared folder. And you can basically download it from here. You can review it online, and you can also post comments. If the text you want to share with your colleagues and work on it, you can just do it directly from here.
Oh, yes, there are some suggestions. You see, and it's shared between two people, between my private account and my institutional account, in this case. So you can have more than one account, probably, as well, if you have different email addresses. This is it. It's relatively simple. Yeah.
Is there a method of version control? Oh, yeah.
You
mean
the
manuscripts?
Yes, or sharing documents.
Yeah.
So it freezes this version.
Okay. So this is basically our message. If you have questions.
Yeah, come on, I'll give you. I already sort of get recommendations emailed to me from sites I read. Whereabouts?
Yeah.
I make the search platform. I have some of my saved searches, and then I have sort of weekly, bi-weekly, I get a list of recommended articles. I have no idea how they select these, and sometimes they don't.
I showed you was a search, and
so you'll get an email alert when you
You can get you get email alerts periodically, and you can suppress those which doesn't have anything new.
Right.
So that's a little bit other way around. So those are my my stored searches. And this one here, I can add or modify alerts. Oh, well, actually, for all of them, there's a frequency, and for each one, for me, it's never because I don't need those emails.
Demo purpose, but you can put in those options
there, and you'll get the emails with the list as well. But the thing is that they are also sitting here, so you can basically save them, and you can also save them to F1000. But first of all, you need to determine if it's relevant for you. It will be added to your search, and then you can save those articles. Yes, you can have searches. They don't need to be smart searches. They can be just normal searches as well. And I have here the PubMed searches, for example. That's a PubMed search that has been just done right now. And those are articles coming from PubMed, not from F1000. And again, you can save them. You can select them all. I know they are not in autism, sorry about that. But I'm adding to the same autism folder. You see, there's something new here. And those are recommended. And this one even has a PDF, which you can open and annotate. So when I refresh, yeah, it's already marked here as a note. And if you share a folder, then if you have a group, then notes and comments from the group will also be added.
Same on the PDF, you can share it in your notes, so worldwide
collaboration. It's part of the university subscription.
There's a human version. There's an individual subscription possibility. There's a lab subscription possibility. And for university, it's part of the prime subscription. Mm-hmm. And if you share a folder, a project with people who are outside, they will get all the information.
If it's
there
is a trial version, for one month, and if a person doesn't buy a con,
there are
just limitations.
Just
limitations.
Suggestions.
And can you have like a desktop version?
Desktop version, not really. We have installers. You can have a list of articles for the writing list, and you can use it for uploading PDF, for example, just
right.
Drop and drop, and it uploads PDF. Yeah, but it's mostly. Do you have a need to open to go offline? Is there a need?
I mean, you do get people that have a pathological appetite to do work, you know, so they're on the airplane or train or anywhere north of the Wi-Fi is it great?
Even in central.
Because you can, can you work offline?
No, it's online.
You have to be connected. At the moment, we are working on the ability to work online, but work on an option to give it more like Drive. So you on your browser, you sync some data, for example, you don't care. It's something I add those PDFs to read and listen. Still will be able to use your workspace in a browser, so say not to mention just
You can import directly from Mendeley if you have a Zotero account, all this stuff. So you can just from here you can log in to Zotero and import, but not from EndNote. From EndNote.
I was so curious that I even installed one myself to see how it works. And it's sort of nice because you have everything on your computer. But if you're using some other computer, you're in trouble. If you want to share it with somebody with a different version of EndNote, God forbid, you're in trouble again. And there's a lot of fantastic tools, but you don't need them all. So,
much in the same way.
only to mention that you can just add references directly from search results. You could put a link here that should normally bring in
without
properly.
Exactly, that's why I'm sort of saying,
I think we're limited in our expectations. Mm-hmm. We're just building an environment when you can write. The writing environment, where you write, communicate, and then publish. So it's not for everything you do. And I would say, I think it's an enormous task, because everybody does things differently. I think most of people are doing still paper notebooks when they do research. I've talked with some chemistry PhDs, they just have a large notebook and make notes on the side. And I think there will be more than one tool, probably still already more than one tool of this sort, and they probably don't mingle between themselves very well. So that's just one of those maybe.
And prime is a different thing.
It's personal communication, basically.
I'm curious, this comes from a place of complete ignorance now, so really, but does it
Prime?
Yeah.
Yeah, why not? I don't think there's any pressure on a particular language, but somehow it happens that I think most of research that's valuable and worth recommending to others should be in English.
I've always been curious.
I don't think anybody there
sure
would be.
There were physical indicators.
why. There's a chat here for workspace. So if you have any questions, then use workspace. They go either to Olya, but sometimes to other people like Chris, Smith, and other Chris, a couple of others, and they respond to other people, especially in the same time zone.
It's a real person.
Yeah, I was
going to
say,
you can see pictures there.
Okay, well, thank you again.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
I'm not sure I pushed your knowledge to the brink.
No. It's definitely it's made me reconsider my appreciation of the tarot.
Please do, because you can go directly.
Yeah.
And then for the export as well.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But I've been using sometimes a lot of Mendeley when doing
this. Oh, God.
It's so easy from a tablet to import directly PDF in any format.
Yeah.
But then in order to run, I've been using WordPress because it's so easy to use with Word.
Well, I just find this for people recommending software, research software. So, that's a bit more better. Yes. And it shouldn't be a job that you have to do to have to check that the reference list is all correct and everything is there. That you should be a reference. I know it's not necessarily the reference management software that's the issue. It's usually how it's stored on whether it's prepared or software or whatever. But that's the frustrating thing as well. And because the software usually refreshes. That is the most, the number of hours, I think it's almost criminal actually, the number of hours. And I'm being deadly serious because it takes a lot of time to go through and to just change the most, it stings twice because first you waste your time doing it and second you're not paid to do it and it's a job that the journalist should do anyway. So, and there are fire, I think. Allows you to make a sort of regular submit to certain journals. But
what we need to, in case it's some kind of we have the main style, then this is formatting that is similar to some style but slightly different
yeah.
from a specific journal, because we create ourselves an impression from before someone asks it, and it's not something, you know, like extremely
yes, but it only relates to the reference that you have to work on the whole document.
Yeah, this is the whole document.
Yeah,
yeah, but it
will
be forward. If
I
you install a new style, it will, and you add
yes,
it.
Yes, but different journals require a different structure of the article.
But in terms
yes.
of the, yeah, it's the basic template, sure. Because, I mean, LaTeX does that already. I think particularly, you know, the sort of yeah, it's just, I think this, that people will look back on this. If somebody could do a PhD or paper just to show how many hours it takes to read formats, it's already a lengthy process, isn't it, to publish. You have to wait 3 months before you get anything back. It's horrible, and particularly in my field, like neurology papers. Yeah, exactly. So that's the
brilliant.
So there are some journals that do the your paper your way, and they just ask you to do intro methods to switch it. That's it. And I think there is a move towards that format now, rather than it's either they move completely and they